Keeping all those things in mind, what I have decided that I will give you a complete package on nanoscience and nanotechnology. Of course, it will be a little bit superficial, but it will be a complete package. It will include everything. Even after after my talk, if I miss something, you can ask me at that point. I will try to discuss all those things. I have outlined my talk like this about nanomaterials to nanoscience and nanotechnology, brief history, their preparation characterization, their applications, and what are the concerns and challenges are there, and what is our hope and hype about nanomaterials. So I'll try to cover up everything. It will be a complete package, okay? But the most important thing is it will be a type of pedagogic type lecture. I will not go in details of anything. So those who are seniors, those who are expert in this line, please excuse me. But of course, there is enough scope always to discuss in anything in details after this presentation. So this will be a most generalized talk. In which I will try to show some of the results of our group, which are most important. So that is in brief about my presentation. So starting from the very beginning, nano, what does it mean? Basically, nano is a Greek word. It means dwarf. And it is 1 nanometer is 10 to the power minus 9 meter. And if you want to visualize, it is like an array of 10 hydrogen atoms in a single line. So that is about nano. And if you say about the definition of nanomaterial, so conventionally it is the material in which at least one dimension, among three dimensions, at least one dimension should be less than 100 nanometer. And that dimension could be diameter of particle, it could be grain size, it could be layer thickness, it could be length of anything. But if you ask me precisely, it should be the size where the quantum size effect prevails. And why I am talking about the quantum size effect? Because until and unless you are going to that level, you will not get the effect of nano size. Otherwise, the properties will be remain almost same for bulk material. And it is very much understandable from this equation in this right-hand side corner, that this length should be something around d by wavelength. From very basic physics, you can just calculate that it will be of the order of d by wavelength. But I must say that in some cases, for some material, if it is not at that smaller range, then also we can get some effect of smaller size. And if we define this nanoscience, it is the fundamental study of fundamental principles, structure, and everything of very small particle, and roughly the particles which dimension is between 1 to 100 nanometers. And nanotechnology, it is a completely new technology where the smallest size particles, nanoparticles, is used to prepare some device, precisely nano device. So that is nanotechnology, which is completely different from other technologies. Now, to give you a more realistic picture about what is nano, what nano means, please look at this picture. From the right-hand side, it is from bigger size to this length, which is of the order of millimeter or sub-millimeter. That part we can see with our open eye, without any instrument, with unaided eye. But if you go below this length, means from sub-nano to sub-micron level, this medium range, there it is not possible to see the things with our open eye or unaided eye. Like in this range, all the plant and animal cells belongs to in this range. Some bigger nucleus also fall in this group. Some bigger size bacteria also fall in this group. So see all those things. So we need some kind of microscope, and generally light microscope is enough to see all these particles. Anyway, am I audible to everybody? Hello? Hello?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. You're audible, sir.
Yes, sir. Audible, sir.
Okay. So after this range, if you go again below, maybe from submicron to nanometer range, where the smallest size bacteria, virus, ribosome, protein, lipid, even atoms are there, in that range, that is basically we call nano-dimensional range or nanomaterial range. So it is like some molecule or some grain like that, and the, some proteins, lipid, they are also belongs to this group. So these, if you want to see them, you need a very specialized instrument. Particularly, it is typically it is called electron microscope, and most common electron microscope which is used is transmission electron microscope that I will talk. So that is about nanomaterials, nanoscience, and nanotechnology. Now, little bit of history about this nanoscience and nanotechnology. Actually, great physicist Richard Feynman, during one conference in dinner, after dinner talk, he says that the principle of physics, as far as I can see, do not speak against the possibilities of maneuvering things atom by atom. Please note, atom, that time only in 1959, he predicted the maneuvering things atom by atom. And his this famous line, there is enough room at the bottom. And in 1974, Japanese scientist Taniguchi, Professor Taniguchi, he used first time this nanotechnology term in his article published on sputtering machine. So I was talking about this Feynman's things, maneuvering things atom by atom. So at the last part of this 20th century, it was possible not by atom, from atom to atom, but molecule to molecule, maneuvering molecule to molecule was possible. And this kind of spectacular structure, some spectacular coral has been drawn during that period, during 98 to 2000. This is nano corals of different type. And this side, right hand side, this is nano abacus, which I think the pictures are very clear to you all also. So all that has been made by this famous company IBM. So they have already shown that, yes, what Feynman has said, that is more or less perfect and correct. So using just some STM tip, they have made this kind of particular structures. So about the history, as was I was talking, it is not that, in that sense, it is not new. Actually, nano was there from the very starting of our human civilization. These are called stained glass that you can see in some old churches. So this is this stained glass is particularly, this term is used for the old churches, which means the color glass. And this kind of color glass has been made using some nano size metal atoms, metal ions, but it was not under their control. So same thing like this. This is very famous Leica scarf. This scarf is actually, if you see, if this scarf can be seen like red, green, and different color, depending upon from which side ray is coming, light is coming. So if you see this scarf in transmission mode, then it will be red. If you see this scarf in reflection mode, it will appear like green. This Leica scarf is right now available also in British Museum at London. This is a very famous thing, and this is very important for nanoscience. It has been made maybe at the beginning of this era, but without knowing anything. Even up to 1,700 years, nobody knows about what is the science behind it. So now, in fact, nanomaterials are there, a lot of nanomaterials there in our body system also, like protein, DNA, ribosome, antibody, virus, some small bacteria, red blood, all these are in nanometer dimension. So that was there from the very beginning of human civilization, more precisely from very beginning of life. So now the question may come, then what is the new thing? Why people are saying nano like this? New is that earlier when we have made these nano things like this stained glass, this Leica scarf, we was not able to handle anything. and also the nanomaterials, nano things which are there in our body system also, that has been gifted by Mother Nature. We cannot do anything. So now new thing is we can prepare this nanomaterial with desired size and shape. We can also manipulate them, we can move them, we can make any shape with that nanoparticle. So that is the new thing. That's why nano is so important and people are trying to jump into this nanoscience and nanotechnology. So nano is nowadays the buzzword. It has application in every sector. It is helping our life and livelihood in all the ways. So it has impact on pharmaceuticals, on medical lines, on automotive lines, and in even in strategic sector, it is playing important roles. It has importance in agricultural industries, in textile industry, in electronics industries. It has also great impact on energy related things, on environmental things. So it is everywhere. In fact, that's why scientists throughout the world has jumped into the sea of nanoscience and nanotechnology, and everybody wants to contribute something so that ultimately at the end of the day, society can get the benefit of nanoscience and nanotechnology. That's why everybody is trying this nanoscience and nanotechnology. But now, why nano? Question is why nano? Why people are jumping into it? Actually, it has been proven that in nanometer dimension, same material can give much more superior properties than their bulk counterpart, in particular regarding with respect to mechanical strength, thermal stability, conductivity, magnetic properties, optical properties. They are much more superior for a particular material in nano range than their bulk. Also, as I mentioned, it has lot of application, wide range of application in different field. Not only that, nanomaterial has also created a lot of new areas like nanofabrication, nano device fabrication, nanobiology, nanotoxicology, nanocatalyst, everything. And also it is generating some new fundamental sciences also. So that are the thing. That's why nano is so important and people are crazy about nano. And another important thing, which I will discuss later part of my lecture, that is, it is also possible to generate some new functionality in material, in any material, you can create some new functionality. So that's why nano is the buzzword and everybody wants to jump into this nanoscience and nanotechnology scene. Also, there are some, as I said, that nano can give some superior property than their bulk counterpart. Similarly, there are a lot of strikingly opposite properties also if we compare with their bulk counterpart. Like a ferromagnetic or ferrimagnetic materials become paramagnetic material, precisely super paramagnetic material, while goes down to nanometer dimension. On the other hand, a paramagnetic material can show ferromagnetic properties. Also, metal can behave like semiconductor. Ductile material can show super plasticity. And one of the most important thing, which is very common to everybody, that is gold. Gold become ordinary metal, it loses its shine and color. So these are the striking feature of nanomaterials. So come to the gold part. This is this picture of some gold bar, and this gold has a typical color, though it does not belong to this bevzier, but it has a typical color. And if we say the gold, everybody can imagine the color. And this is more or less the same color of gold, which is placed here, the gold bar. But if you go to the nanometer dimension of gold, like meso gold is nothing but a colloidal solution of gold nanoparticles, then you will see how the color is changing. So this is a bottle of meso gold, which is available in the market. And in fact, Sigma is selling this meso gold. It's all Sigma Aldis. Beside that, if you change the particle size of gold in nanometer dimension, you'll be able to create the color from this one light blue to this light orange or light pink type. And also, more precisely, if you see this picture, This is basically left-hand side. This picture is the color of 100 nanometer gold particle. This is reddish one is 20 nanometer gold particle. And this is one nanometer gold particle, which is a little bit brown yellow color. So that is the beauty of nanoscience and nanotechnology, because the change in a lot of internal properties, which earlier we think that it cannot be changed, because of that only this kind of striking feature is coming. So this is about gold. I think those who are not aware about this gold nanoparticle, they can now understood that gold totally loses its color and shine, and it becomes an ordinary metal if we go to the nanometer size. So the question is, what I have till now I have discussed with you, why this kind of strange phenomena appears in nanometer dimension? That is the most important questions, and there lies a lot of science for this kind of things. So mainly four important things are there, which I will discuss in my next slide one by one. That four important parameter, one is this left hand side. It is called this surface to volume ratio or surface energy. This one is the number of atom in the surface. This one is the band gap, and this one is the domain size. Okay, so if we go one by one, surface to volume ratio, if you consider this block, this cube of one nanometer, you see that it has six face, so that cube has area, surface area 6 meter square. But if we cut into 8 pieces, the surface area increases to 12 meter square. And if we cut it into the 27 pieces, the surface area increases 18 meter square, though the volume remains same. That means if you go from bigger size to smaller size, your surface to volume ratio will increase, rather your surface energy will increase. And same thing happen when a drop of mercury drop fall into this ground, it becomes create lot of droplets, where volume remains same, total volume remains same, but the surface area increases enormously. And for nanomaterials, this increase of surface to volume ratio is one important factor for which its reactivity and other many property changes drastically. So that is one important factor. The second one is band gap of material, particularly for this metal, semiconductor, and also for insulator also, you can say. So if you look at the basic physics, if you consider a single atom, all of us know that atom has some atomic level. And if you go from this right hand side, from this atom to bigger size molecule to bigger molecule grain, and then ultimately bigger material, then you will find that your these atomic levels slowly overlap, and ultimately it comes to this band. So that is the concept of formation of band. Now you think in opposite way. So for bulk particle, you have a band, and if you go on decreasing the size from bulk towards this atomic level, naturally your band gap will increase, and ultimately at the end, in the atomic dimension, this band will vanish and it will come to an atomic level. So that is the concept. So band gap can tune as per your desire, as you want, and accordingly with the change of this band gap, particularly electrical and thermal property changes a lot. Also opticals. This is a very famous picture, which this right hand side, which shows that this is for cadmium sulfide nanoparticles, which shows that if you change the size in nanometer dimension, it goes from this color to this color. So something has changed. Anyway, so this is the original place where the color has changed. Now, go there. How to go to the next slide? Hello.
Sir, yes, sir.
Yeah, I think it has gone to somewhere else. This one has opened, so I have. So next slide, I am not able to go. So I think I have to disconnect again, no?
But we can able to see your slide, sir. But it is not changing. Am I right, sir?
Yeah, it's not changing. So I have to change. So shall I go out again?
Sir, there will be some issues, I think, sir. If you go out, there will be some issues, I think, sir.
Then how to do it? Okay, let me check. Okay, yeah, it has came.
Okay, sorry, sir. Okay, sir. Okay.
Yeah. Okay, so sorry for the interruption.
No problem.
Okay,
no problem.
So what I was saying, this particular picture is for this cadmium sulfate, where if you change the dimension in nanometer range, you can create any color. It says that dial a color, you will be able to get that color. So that is second important point. I have talked about four important points. One is surface to volume in ratio or surface energy. Second is this change of band gap. Third important factor is number of atoms at the surface. If you consider a sphere like 12 or 13 nanometer, it has been observed that 10% of atoms are there in the surface for that particular particles. But same particle, if you go down to a much smaller range, like 5 nanometer range, then 25% number of atoms are available in the surface. That means from this picture, you can see the number of atoms in the surface increases enormously when you go the molar size. And that is also one important factor which particularly affects the surface activated properties like this, this sensing properties, some surface related absorption and other things which just depends on, depends on surface property, that will change drastically because of this number of increase of number of surface atoms. Okay, so that is third important factor. And the fourth one is another. So because of increase in this, this is a particular example I want to share with you, that melting point of any material decreases drastically if you go to nanometer size, that is shown in this graph also, this one, because of this number of available more atoms on the surface. So this is the third point. And the fourth important point, which is true for particularly magnetic particles. You know, magnetic particles, magnetism we explain with the domain concept. Any magnetic material, if we try to analyze its magnetic property, we consider that it consists of a lot of domains, which is there a bigger particle in the right hand side. So, and inside a domain, all the moments are aligned in the same direction, but from domain to domain, moment direction are different. And as a whole, for bulk material, we don't get any magnetic property. Now, you go on decreasing the size, and it will come ultimately a single domain size, which is shown here in this line. So there, basically, one bigger domain is available. That means inside a domain, all the moments is in the same direction. So you are coming to a point where there is no moment in other direction. That is called a single domain size. And if you go beyond that size, which is called the superparamagnetic region, there moments will be again in it is single domain definitely, but all that moments will be randomly oriented and it behaves like paramagnetic, but it is little bit different. We call it super paramagnetic because its moments is little bit higher. So what I mean to say that for what I have said earlier also, that for a ferro and ferrimagnetic material, if you go from bulk to this nanometer size, it will become a paramagnetic particle. So these are the four important parameters which are responsible for drastic change in properties when you go to this nanometer dimension. Now coming to type of nanomaterials. Nanomaterials could be zero-dimensional, one-dimensional, two-dimensional, and also three-dimensional, which is rather bulk. So zero-dimensional, which we call as this is called quantum dot. In fact, for zero dimension, they are really very small. In fact, it should be quantum dot should be on principle below 10 nanometer. And in that case, all the three dimension will be restricted. For one dimensional means nanowire, nanotube like this, they are actually two dimensional is restricted. Only one dimension length you can change. For two dimensional nanomaterial like this, thin film, Here one direction is restricted, means thin film thickness is restricted. You cannot go beyond a certain limit, then it will lose its nanostructure property. So thickness is restricted. Other to length and width, you can change. Even then also it will remain nanomaterial because its thickness is on nanometer scale. And last one is three-dimensional, which is bulk particle. There is no restriction. All three-dimensional you can change. So these are the type of nanomaterials. Now coming to the synthesis part, how we prepare nanomaterials in our laboratory. Grossly speaking, there are two approaches altogether. One is top-down approach, another is bottom-up approach. Top-down approach is like top-down means you from bulk you are going to down means atomic level, and bottom-up means from atomic level you are going to bulk size. So left-hand side of this slide shows this top-down approach, means this is a bigger size. So from there this is, and from there this, and then this. On the other hand, if you change the arrow, then it will be bottom-up approach. So this is like this molecular range on the right-hand side. This then there is bigger particle, then grain, and then the bulk particle. So that is called bottom-up approach. So common top-down approaches are high energy ball milling, laser ablation, ion scattering, thermal evaporation, like all those things. For common bottom-up approaches, soil gel, hydrothermal, hydrolysis, chemical row, co-precipitation, and all those. So these are the common synthesis process. In either or way, you can come to this nanometer size, and all the process has some pros and cons. If somebody is interested, we can discuss later also. But these are grossly the technique by which you can prepare nanoparticles in your laboratory. Some of them are very common, very easy. We call facile synthesis, and it does not need any big instrument or any big technique. So anybody can prepare nanoparticles in any lab. In fact, in colleges also it is possible to prepare nanoparticles. Particularly if you follow chemical routes, you don't need any instrument also. So once you have prepared this nanoparticle, then comes the question of characterization. As you know, if your background is material science, solid state, condensed matter physics, or metallurgy, you know that common characterizing tools for materials are XRD, BPA, this spectroscopic technique, all those things are common characterizing tools. But when we are talking particularly about this nanomaterial, in that case, it's not the optical microscope, even in some cases, not the scanning electron microscope. Precisely, it is the TEM, transmission electron microscope, which is required to see the nanoparticles and their structure. So that is the most important and commonly used tools for this characterization of these nanoparticles or nanomaterials. Though it is a costly instrument, but that is required. So this is the picture of a very common TEM machine, transmission electron microscope. This is made of ZEISS, but there are many other companies. There are Philips, there is Bruker, there are a lot of other companies. This one is the micrograph taken from a TEM instrument, micrograph of nanoparticle. You see, very small size nanoparticles are there in the picture. They are almost uniform in size. We call this monodispersed particle. How basically it works, here in the top part of this instrument, there is some kind of electron generator. Actually, electron beam is used for this TEM. So there is an electron generator, and below there is a source for this creating high voltage. So electron beam passes through high voltage. It is very high, of the order of 200 kilovolt, 300 kilovolt, like that. And sample is placed somewhere in between in this slot like here. And So in between sample is placed, and we see it on transmission mode. That's why this is called transmission electron microscope. And if you see this bottom structure, I don't know whether it is clearly visible or not. You see there are some sort of parallel lines. They are basically the planes, parallel planes. You know, all the crystal planes are parallel. in a particular H scale Miller indices. So in TEM, not only the size, you can also characterize the particle. So from the gap of these particular parallel lines, distance between these parallel lines, you can on principle identify which material this is. You can calculate this difference, and from there, by comparing with standard JCPDS5, you can understand what material is. So both viewing the particles and characterization is possible with this transmission electron microscope. That's why this is very important tool for now. Let me talk about some very common applications of these nanomaterials. Actually, grossly, nanomaterial has made our life more easier, and day by day it will be much more easier. It can prepare material with much lighter weight, more stronger, faster, smaller, high storage density, more durable. So this kind of things is possible, and some of them are already available in the market. So I will show you some applications directly. So this is this right hand side is air conditioner. This left hand side is washing machine. All of you have noticed that nowadays companies sell this. They said that they have this nano things for which it has the property of antibacterial. Actually, they use some kind of nano coatings on the outer surface of the from which the AC air comes out, so that. That silver can give some antibacterial things to this outer side, this air. Similarly, there is some kind of nano silver coating in washing machine also. So for antibacterial, they use this kind of thing. So that application is there already in the market. This is we call quantum dot LED. So this picture shows that from blue to yellow to red, everything you can create every color from the same material just by tuning the band gap, and for that you have to just tuning the size of the same material. You don't need any doffing, you don't need any coloring color glass to create the color. So glass will be transparent, but the material itself, it is its intrinsic property, like material itself will be generate different color if you change the dimension. So that is also available now in the market. This is this tennis ball. It has already used in Davis Cup. They by giving some kind of nano coating, they are able to create more longer bounds, which will help them to play the tennis. That has also in the has already used during Davis Cup. This is Behr Paints. Behr Paints is a US based very big paint company. They use some kind of nanoparticles in their paints as a colloidal solution, just to make it more durable, anti-fade, and long lasting type. So that is also available in the market. This is Mercedes-Benz. From 2007 onward, they are using some kind of nano, again, in their paints, they use some kind of nanoparticles for scratch resistance things, resistance property. So they use it they are using it from 2007. Yes, this is very common. You see that right-hand side of the face, this is powder or this cream earlier player used while they are playing in sun. So that is not transparent. In fact, that is that was that's why this is looks like white. But if you see the left hand side, this is very transparent. It appears that there is no cream on left hand side of the face, but it's not true. Left hand side also has some cream. All those creams are basically zinc oxide powder based cream. Here, the size of this zinc oxide powders is less than 25 nanometers. That's why that is transparent to sun, and that's why it will appear that the player does not use any screen. So that is also there available in the market. Now, some clothes company are using this nano silver again for this antimicrobial properties. That is also available in market. They are a little bit costly, but that is also available in the market. They eliminate the bad odor also from the clothes. Even now, scientists are thinking about this application of nano in the food for preservation without refrigeration. They are also trying to protect nano this food from bacteria and some other diseases. also now scientists I read an article that in NASA they are trying to prepare some kind of food which will be very lighter for their people who, those who will venture into the open sky, open space. So nano is even applicable in that level also. So as of now, I have discussed about a lot of things. What is nano, how they are prepared, what is their characteristics and technique, and I have shown some common applications of nanomaterials which are already in the market. Now little bit I'll go a little bit of science or some R&D work of our group. I told you in a slide that it is not only drastic change, not only the superior property of nanoparticles in comparison with their bulk, also during at this nanoparticle stage lot of new properties can appear. I have told you. So now I will show that we are able to create some new properties in some very common material. So that's why we call some multifunctional material. For example, I have selected some work of my group on zinc oxide, on BFO, it is called bismuth ferrite, and on some ferrites. So I'll just go through very quickly, but to give you flavor that yes, it is possible to generate some new properties, new functionalities in common material. For example, zinc oxide, everybody knows this is a inorganic compound, structure is ursite, and it is a 2-4 semiconductor. It has high reflective index and it is very good for sensing material. And also, you see, I have written in bigger size, it is non-magnetic and also white in color. Why I have written this in bigger size? Because now I will show that we are able to change these two properties, this non-magnetic and white color, by creating some, by producing some zinc oxide nanoparticles. So we have used some simple chemical technique to prepare nanoparticles. That left hand side top micrograph shows the nanoparticles of zinc material prepared by chemical route. The top right hand side is the standard XRD pattern for that, which confirms that preparation of nanomaterials. The bottom left hand side is the TEM selected area diffraction pattern. It shows some ring with some spot that indicates that it has a smaller particle, and also if you calculate the diameter of the ring, from that it is possible to understand which material is. So in that case it is zinc oxide that has been, so it has been confirmed from XRD as well as from TEM. Now the interesting thing which I want to share with you, that is the bottom right corner slide, right corner picture, which is magnetic moment versus field. I want to show you that this nanoparticle of zinc oxide, which are conventionally non-magnetic, we are able to create magnetic moment on that nanoparticle, and that is placed here in this graph, in right hand side corner, this bottom graph. Okay, that means it is possible to create magnetism in zinc oxide. Now about color of zinc oxide, I told that zinc oxide, if you purchase zinc oxide from some chemical company, you will see that it is completely white. But I told you that it is possible to create color also. So we have prepared some zinc oxide nano ring using some CTAB as a as a network former, you can say. So that nano ring, it gives many interesting properties, including some magnetic properties. But the most interesting thing to me, which I wanted to share with you, that it shows some violet blue color. That means in this nano size in ring shape, that the white zinc oxide has changed to violet violet blue color. In fact, if you change the size of zinc oxide, then lot of defects will create in the mid gap state, and on principle you can create all the colors for zinc oxide. So this slide is united color of zinc oxide, and all those things are available in the literature also. So I want to prove you that though zinc oxide is not magnetic, though zinc oxide is white, we are able to create magnetic property, and we are able to create different color in zinc oxide while going down to nanometer dimension. Now come to bismuth ferrite, BF4. This is a bismuth ferrite is basically a perovskite structure. Its common formula is AbO3, where A is basically bivalent, B is generally iron and oxygen. So this perovskite structure is very important. It is called, it is already, it gives multiple properties. It is called multiferroic, means it shows at least two ferroic properties. You know, there are three ferroic properties commonly used. One is ferroelectric, another is ferromagnetic, and is ferroelastic. So this bismuth ferrite is ferroelectric and also not ferromagnetic, but antiferromagnetic, but that is also considered as magnetic property. That's why this is called multiferroic. So this is known that it will show ferroelectric and also magnetic property, antiferromagnetic property. So this is the polarization, P versus polarization versus electric field. That is common. That is common for any bismuth ferrite material, whether it is bulk or nano. So that appears that we have also observed. That is no issue. But the issue is when you are going to nanometer dimension of this BFO, we are able to create not only this antiferro for a particular size, we are able to create ferromagnetic properties. The top left-hand side corner, this graph, it is ferromagnetic properties, and also the bottom right-hand side graph here, this is the this is basically we called FC and ZFC property, means field cool and zero field cool measurement, and this kind of property shows that yes, it is ferromagnetism. So by going to this nanometer dimension, it is possible to create ferromagnetic property. Actually, it is antiferromagnetic and ferroelectric, but not ferromagnetic, but it is possible to create ferromagnetism in nanometer dimension. Again, if we dove different rare earth and transition metal, it gives much more effect on this ferromagnetic and good ferromagnetic properties, which is there in the hysteresis loop also. Now I will talk about some ferrites, rather soft ferrites or spinel ferrites. They are also ceramic material, inorganic material. Their common formula is AB2O4. A generally a bivalent metal. B is in general iron oxide, iron and O4. So this is a permanent magnetic material. More precisely, they are ferrimagnetic, not ferromagnetic. And they are used for high frequency applications also. So all those are known. Which is not known and which is rare, that I will show you. So these are very common conventional magnetic properties of this kind of spinel ferrite. I am not going into details. So which is not known is that if we go down to nanometer scale, so in bulk size, in right hand side, around 30 nanometer sensitivity is almost zero. But if we go down to nanometer size, then you see that sensitivity increases enormously. So that is the important thing. These ferrite materials, though they are magnetic material, and earlier it was not known to us that it can give a gas sensing property, but they can sense some gases very nicely and sensitivity is very good. So that is one new property creation on ferrites when you are going down to nanometer scale. So this is some gas sensing properties of this nanocrystalline ferrites. This is our data. We have done all those things. This is published data also. Not only that, this is the polarization for a nickel ferrite material on nanocrystalline state. Even though these are they are ferromagnetic, this ferrite in bulk, even in nanocrystalline state, they can show ferroelectricity also. This nice polarization picture is the proof of that, that you can create this ferroelectricity also for these nanoparticles. If we go to the below certain level in dimension. So all these are new property for common material. So that is my point, that we can create a lot of new functionalities in some common material, which was earlier not known, but because of this nano dimension, we can create that property. I've already discussed a lot of applications of nanomaterials, which are generally first generation application we call. But nanomaterials are very promising for this biomedical application, very, very promising. Though they are not using that much nowadays also, it needs much more clinical trial, but they have very good application, promising application for this MRI contrast agent, for magnetic hyperthermia, for drug delivery. Earlier, for this MRI contrast agent, we use some kind of rare earth and radioactive type of things, which are very toxic and hazardous for our human body. But nowadays, it is possible some kind of iron oxide in magnetite or hematite form to use that for this MRI as a MRI contrast agent. And they are really non-toxic. So for biomedical application, one has to be very careful that the particle, nanoparticles which you are choosing, that should be non-toxic, that chemically stable, that should be uniform in size, and also that should be well dispersed in aqueous media. So one important application is as MRI contrasting agent, and our body system is much more convenient for these magnetic nanoparticles. They can easily excrete through our liver all those particles. So that is a beneficial effect of nano size for this biomedical application, particularly for MRI contrast agent. Also, as for targeted drug delivery, which is nowadays very common, particularly for tumor treatment, for cancer treatment, nowadays everybody, I think, is aware of this targeted drug delivery. So what is the targeted drug delivery? What doctors try to do, they try to carry the drug to the particular place where the tumor or cancer is. How they do this? They attach these nanoparticles with the medicines, magnetic nanoparticle with the real medicines, and they inject that one in a particular place, or they make some tablet, patient swallow them. Then by applying some external magnetic field, you can bring, as it is attached with some magnetic nanoparticles, you can bring all those medicine to this place where the tumor is. Then it can be released at that place only. So that is a very good technique, because in this case, your doses will be very small, and also side effect will be very, very less. So that is also very promising use of nanomaterials in medical science. Another is more important. It is also for tumor and cancer therapy. This is called magnetic hyperthermia. What is that? That is nothing but basically using of some magnetic nanoparticles. Generally, all those are in under clinical trial now. It is not probably used by the doctors, in at least in our country. Maybe in developed country, some of the doctors are using now. What they do, basically, they inject some magnetic nanoparticles at the place of this cancer or tumor. Then what happens? Externally, they applied some magnetic field, AC magnetic field. So you can understand, if you have some magnetic nanoparticles and if you apply some magnetic AC magnetic field, so with the changing of this AC field direction, this moment, magnetic moment will swing from one side to another side like pendulum. And if the frequency is high, then the swing rate will be very, very high, and they will create some temperature, and they can create up to, because our body cell destroy in maybe inside this body cells can destroy around 42 degrees centigrade. So by applying some certain frequency, that particles can swing from one side to another side, from negative positive north pole to south pole, and by that swing, they can create some local heating, and with that heating, it is possible to destroy the cancer cell. So that is called magnetic hyperthermia. I have one video on this, a small video, maybe for 10 seconds, that I will show you later, because I don't want to disturb this slide presentation right now. So once my presentation is finished, then I will try to show that one. But that is the technique which I have explained you for this magnetic hyperthermia. All these are very promising applications of nanoparticles in medical science. So I have talked about a lot of application, and a lot of things are about the nanomaterial. So I am now coming towards the end of my lecture. I will not say it is hype, or I will not say that we will not expect anything, we will not hope anything. But as of now, what I have shown you, what is available application of nanomaterials in the market, they are really fast generation. They are some kind of zinc oxide or titanium oxide nanoparticles, and there are silver nanoparticles which are used with some other materials for some specific application. But it's not in that sense the bigger application of nanomaterials, but nanomaterials can be used in much bigger way. So it's not really high. So we can hope a lot of things in future from nanoscience and nanotechnology. Actually, the thing is, a lot of things are unknown till date to us. It is again kind of this story of like this elephant and 10 blind people. If we cannot understand everything, like in this story, what they have observed, that all those are blind, so they cannot observe exactly what things they are touching. So they have given their impressions, and accordingly, the elephant comes like this picture, this bottom right picture. So nano is like in its this stage right now. So we have to do a lot of more experimental and theoretical works to develop nanoscience and side by side nanotechnology, so that it can be used for the benefit of human being, for the benefit of society. So these are about nanoscience and nanotechnology, but the question is, there are a lot of challenges. So first point is, you have to have better synthesis technique so that you can create really your desired size, shape, desired dispersion, which is most important. If you use chemical route and also if physical route, in most of the cases, you will see the literature, particles are mostly, there are some wide distribution. It's not mono dispersed, but for any particular application, as size is important in nanometer dimension, it has to be a mono dispersed. So that is one challenge from this synthesis point of view. Again, characterizing, though there are a lot of sophisticated tools, modern tools, but still we need much more sophisticated tools so that nanomaterials, particularly atoms, can be maneuvered for creating these nanoparticles for particular application. Also, some care should be needed, particularly for magnetic application and some other application regarding the prevention of this coarsening or agglomeration. If the nanoparticles are dispersed, in most of the cases, if you don't use some surfactant or surface activated things, then they will agglomerate with time, and they lose their properties which are supposed to be there in nano scale. Also, for magnetic particle, one should not reduce the size as much as possible, because in super paramagnetic region, the storing capacity decreases. So you have to maintain a balance for storing capacity, for data storing capacity. So this kind of challenges are there. All those things has to be keep in mind once you are working in this area. So I am almost finishing my talk. So I should say that nanotechnology is still in its infancy, and it is very difficult to conclude anything right at this stage. And conclusion may become a laughing stock in future if we do some conclusion right now. For example, you see, there were some great conclusion by some great scientists or some great personalities in past, like we should close this office. Everything that needs to be invented is already. This is director of US Patent Office. He has made this comment in 1929. In fact, in IBM, they have commented that a few computers should be enough for the whole society. In fact, Bill Gates, in 1982, he comments that 640K should be enough for everyone. So you can understand now, even 640 GB is also not sufficient for our mobile right now. We are now looking for terabyte mobile. So this kind of conclusion will really become laughingstock for nanomaterials. In fact, the last one, the infectious disease, is now history. It is made by US Surgeon General in 1959. So now you can understand very well in this, during this COVID-19 scenario, you can understand whether this infectious disease is history or not. So I don't want to make any comment on conclusion. I just only say that small is beautiful. So I should acknowledge my group people. It is really a teamwork. It's not my own things. In fact, nowadays I am being senior. I am not doing lab work in my own hand. I just guide my student. They create all those properties and all those materials, and also finance mostly we get from CSR and also some other DST and other. So I should acknowledge them. I only said that road is difficult, but will surely lead to somewhere beautiful in future. So thank you very much.
Sir, thank you very much, sir. Sir, really the session was so wonderful, colorful, and as well as very informative, sir.
Thank you.
We are really proud to have such a wonderful session, sir. Sir, shall I ask the participants to post their queries, sir? Dear participants, kindly post your queries in your chat box. By the way, sir will answer to your queries.
Yeah. I am available. You just read the questions. I will try to answer.
Sure, sir. Okay, sir. Yeah. Sir, one question from Ma'am Lakshmi Mangamma.
You can.
Can we use green synthesized?
You can unmute her also.
Pardon? Okay, sir.
You can directly. So now, am I visible to you all?
Yes, sir.
I'm visible, or my slides are visible? Which one?
Sir, both are visible, okay. Sir. Actually,
you can unmute also the
participant
who is interested to ask some question.
Sure.
Yeah,
sir.
Okay.
Ma'am, Srimati Lakshmi, ma'am, can you please unmute your mic and... Yes, ma'am. Please, ma'am.
Yes, sir. Sir, I have a doubt on... Can we use... green synthesis magnetite material for biomedical applications?
Yes, definitely. I have shown. In fact, magnetic material you have to use. Yes. What is your point?
While we are using the green synthesis, we are not getting a uniform size.
No, that's why I have told you now in my slides. Challenges. The first point is you have to prepare uniform size. There are a lot of technique. While preparing the material, you have to adjust a lot of parameters by which you can prepare the uniform size. Now it is possible. You can check literature. There are a lot of literature where uniform size, rather monodispersed nanoparticles preparation is possible. They have already published a lot of articles.
Sir, thank you, sir. Another doubt, sir. What is magnetite imaging, sir? Magnetite imaging. Bioimaging technique.
Yeah. It is imaging. Earlier, imaging is done using some kind of this rare earth type of material, which are toxic. Now, people, as I told, scientists are trying to use this magnetite or hematite for this imaging purpose because they are less harmful, and also it is much easier to excrete all these nanoparticles from our body through urine and through our stool. Okay, so that is magnetite imaging.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Yeah. Welcome.
Sir, good morning, sir.
Yeah, good morning.
I am G. Tejaswini from Nedadavolu Government Degree College, Andhra Pradesh. Very nice presentation, sir. Sir, I have one doubt that if from bulk to nano, band gap increases. So, so metal, it may turn to metal to semiconductor.
Yes.
Then how can I say that nanoparticles have very good electrical properties? In general, we say metals have good electrical properties.
No, I got your point. Good question. Actually, yes. If you require to go to nanometer dimension for metals, then only you go. For example, if you go to nanometer dimension for metals particularly, then the surface plasmon resonance is possible. And also you can use its band gap for particular application. If you don't need that, for example, if you talk about the conductivity of metal, then you don't need to go to this nano size dimension because metals gives very good conductivity in bulk only.
Yes, sir. Another question that shall I ask, sir?
Yes, definitely. If time permit, I have no issue. It's the organizer if they allow.
Sir, how can we differentiate mono dispersed and poly dispersed nanoparticles, sir?
if you go for TEM experiment, TEM study, from the micrograph only, you can see that whether it is monodisperse or not. There are I have shown one TEM slide.
Yes, sir. I think
which was monodisperse, but I have lot of other slides also which are not monodisperse. Like the zinc oxide slide, which I was shared that time. In that case, it is not really monodisperse. I think that slide is there now. You can see this is not monodisperse.
39 slide. It was showing maybe polydisperse.
Yeah. This one. Now the slide is visible.
Yes, sir. It's visible.
Yeah. So left hand side top picture you see. This is in true sense is not monodisperse because there are different size. Okay.
This is
zinc oxide nanocrystal because scale is 50 nano, and yes. Most of them are less than that scale. But the thing is, some bigger particles are also there and some smaller particles. So this is not monodisperse. Okay.
Is there any problem, sir? That means if we get the polydispersed particles in applications.
Yes. If it depends upon what kind of application you are interested in. If it is a very precise application, then you have to be very precise in size also. You can understand now this all these things, band gap and other properties changes with size. So for example, if you prepare a material where 5 nanometers is also there and 100 nanometers is also there. So your property will be the same because 5 nanometers particle is so different property than 100 nanometers particle, definitely.
Yes, sir. Yeah. Sir, another doubt that the gas sensing ferrite nanoparticles can we can use for gas sensing, sir. What is the instrument?
Yeah, I have some good publication on. If you go through internet, if you just Google, you'll find some good publication from my group only, where we have shown that ferrite also can sense some gases, not all gases, some gases, and their sensitivity is also very good. But what in general, till date, mostly zinc oxide, tin oxide are used as gas sensor. But for some typical application, maybe ferrites can be also used, ferrite and multiferrites.
Yes, sir. Thank you very much, sir.
Welcome.
Dear participants, anybody else want to ask questions?
Hello. Sir, I'm Kavita from PSG Tech, Coimbatore.
Yes, ma'am. Please, ma'am.
Sir, it was a very nice presentation. And we are working on nanoparticle synthesis.
Yes.
Sir, is it possible to get...
For what purpose?
Sir, biomaterials. We are synthesizing nanobiomaterial particles.
Okay.
And also we are working on ceramics, nano-ceramics.
Okay, good.
Sir, is it possible to get help from CGCRI to go for characterization?
What kind of characterization you need?
Sir, we want to do magnetic property of the nano.
Magnetic. Sorry, we don't have that much magnetic. One very old instrument is there. Actually, right now, there is only one scientist in CGCRI who is working on magnetic. In fact, nowadays I am also doing very less magnetic. I also collaborate for magnetic properties with some others in BRC, and also I have one collaborator in UK. So I collaborate with them. We don't have any standard squid.
Okay, sir. I'll call you personally and then discuss with you.
You can send mail also because I have in my title slide there. I have given my email address also.
Thank you, sir.
Sir, good afternoon.
Yeah, good afternoon.
I am Chalapati, sir, from Hyderabad, Andhra University.
Yeah.
Sir, how come the nanoparticles we can use to coat as a catalyst, sir, on catalytic converter monolith?
Yes. Some people in our laboratory also at CGCRI, they work on this. I don't work on catalysis, but it is possible to prepare this some kind of these electrodes and other things. It is possible to use these nanoparticles for better performance. But I don't directly work on catalysis.
Okay. Is the ARPA in Hyderabad will help in this regard, sir? Or they won't allow outside?
ARC, I'm not sure, but in ARC also they work on a lot of subject, lot of issues. Maybe there are some good. I'm not aware with all the activities of ARC. But you can check. You can check. Hyderabad, you have a lot of good institute, like you have CCMB, you have IICT, you have the Central University, you have ARC, you have DMRL. I'm sure some in some institute, some group are working on these issues.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Hyderabad is like an educational hub right now.
Dear participants, anybody else have doubts? Okay, sir. I hope everybody has asked their doubts. Sir, now it's a prestigious moment for me to propose a vote of thanks, sir. So first of all, I would like to extend our gratitude for your wonderful presentation as well as your presence here, sir. We are really proud to have such a wonderful guest in our forum, and everybody thoroughly enjoyed it, I hope, sir. And once again, I thank our management, our trustee, our all the higher officials who are in the trust level, as well as our CEO, our advisor, our dean, everybody for continuously motivating and encouraging us for conducting such kind of workshops and BPs, sir. So I would like to thank them also. And in this moment, I would like to thank our HOD, sir, for his continuous support and his without his continuous cooperation as well as his efforts, this thing may not be possible today. So I once again, I like to extend my heartfelt thanks to our HOD, sir, Dr. Sabir Nathan, sir. And I would like to thank all our colleagues as well as our student friends who are continuously helping with us to arrange such kind of workshops and seminars. And with their support and as a teamwork, I hope we'll take these kind of things to a very good height. And finally, the participants who made us to feel proud in this moment because of their wonderful participation in this FDP, as well as we got a very, very, very healthy as well as very, very appreciable number of participants registered as well as participated in today's session also. Apparently in YouTube Live also we have a session, and many of them had attended it. And I hope everybody have thoroughly enjoyed this session. And once again, I would like to thank all the participants and each and every member who are present in this forum for its wonderful support and cooperation. And once again, I'd like to thank, sir, for your beautiful presentation as well as sharing your expertise and
thank you,
experience with us, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, everybody. Yeah, thank you.
Thanks. Shall we close the session, sir?
Yeah, sure.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much, sir. Yeah.